WTN's Todd Hultman is our grain market analyst this week. The USDA Thursday released its latest estimates on world supply and demand. The agency lowered soybean ending stocks 15 million bushels to 370 million. It raised corn ending stocks by 50 million bushels by reducing expected feed and residual use. Internationally, the USDA believes stronger yields will raise Argentina's soybean production by 1 million metric tons for a record output of 57 million metric tons. Brazil's remained unchanged at 94.5 million metric tons. We talked with Todd Wednesday afternoon before the report and began by looking at how markets have reacted after numbers on stocks and prospective plantings were released on the 31st.
On the 31st, Jeff, it was a little bit bearish for corn mainly, and that's where the surprise was. We had a few more acres than were expected, and the March 1 stocks total for corn was higher than expected. So that gave corn a big one-day sell-off, but it's regrouped pretty well since then and trended steady.
So you wrote this week about the demand pace for soybeans, and you say it's blistering. Describe to me what that means.
Yeah, it's very surprising to me. At the start of this year, if you go back to last fall, we just had a record harvest here in the U.S., lots of beans. We started out the season with 4 billion bushels of soybeans. March 1 stocks, here we are at the halfway point, and we're down to 1.3 billion bushels. That means two-thirds of our soybean supply is gone. So how does the second half demand going to come out? That's the big question. If I look back historically, second half demand for soybeans is obviously going to be slower because we're going to have the competition of Brazil. There's no argument there. But the question is how much slower? Over the past 10 years, soybean demand in the second half has ranged from 26 to 38%. Only three times has it been below 30%, and all three of those times, soybean prices had to be above $14 to help ration that demand. We don't have anything like that now. So if we have 30% use in the second half, conservatively speaking, we're down closer to 100 million bushels than we are 385.
So what does that mean for prices in that near term then?
Well, you think they'd be climbing higher right now, but the market's been very slow to come to understand this. What we do see, though, is a strong reaction from the commercial side of the market. They are heavily long in the soybean futures market, a bit of a surprise, but not when you understand the demand that may lie in front of us. At the heart of this is understanding China's appetite, and that's the real thing that's hard to guess. It's been hard for USDA to estimate. And that's no criticism of USDA, but it's a very dynamic environment. It's tough to outguess, and USDA, five of the past 7 years, has underestimated demand. I think they're doing it again.
You've also written about the overall world supply in 2015. What catches your eye when you look at that?
You know, I've been around commodities a long time, and it seems like every year there's a theme. Last year, we had phenomenal growing conditions, not only here in the U.S., set aside the Southwestern Plains, but just about every major wheat region around the world had good growing weather last year. That was a phenomenal confluence of events. Here in 2015, I think the theme is much different. We have low grain prices around the world. We have some major growing areas with some very problematic economies. Ukraine and Russia are both seeing serious declines in their currencies. Credit is hard to obtain. Their input prices are rising because their currencies are dropping so rapidly. So they're caught in a very tough situation, and they're likely to use much less fertilizer and maybe go to a lower yielding seed. So overall, I think there's going to be a trend around the world this year of lower yields, and that's before we even talk about weather.
So the strength of the dollar, you focused on that a little bit as well. A lot of people have in grains and outside. Tell me how it's affecting exports and what you think it might do, how strong or weak it might get.
Okay. Well, the dollar is definitely bearish for exports, particularly wheat, where the grain is more competitive overseas. We haven't seen it hurt soybean exports so much. But sometimes I think the dollar gets too much blame for what's going on. There is a strong fundamental trend for it. It is justified. Europe's having problems. They're very slow. At the same time, we're growing, and we're talking about raising our interest rates very soon, and that's what's really attracting investors to the dollar. Yes, that does hurt our grain exports, but not overall. The bigger concern for grain this year is going to be competition of supplies around the world.
What's your near-term outlook on prices for both corn and soybeans, and in so, where you think producers might be able to target a few sales?
Okay. You know, if you asked me this a year ago, it would have been much easier to answer this question. We had $5 corn and $14 beans. Now we've got new crop corn prices under $4 and likewise on beans. So this is very tough what to do here. Corn has a neutral fundamental outlook. I don't see any big change this year unless we have a weather surprise. And that's probably going to keep prices around that $4 level. But I don't see a big sell-off. But that's not great news for guys renting ground, I understand. On the soybean side, because of the demand situation, I do feel that there is an opportunity to trade higher. But still, it's, I think, always a good idea to look at cheap put options to protect yourself on the downside. And the good news is the past 3 to 4 months, trading in grains has been so quiet and the volatility has been so low that those option premiums have really come down. So there is an opportunity here to at least give yourself a floor so if something bad does happen, you can at least sleep at night.